Bill Connelley of ESPN has Tennessee ranked in the 100s in terms of returning production for the 2024 football season. What's this mean, and why I have an issue with some of this? All that and more here on a Friday, Locked On Vols.
You are Locked On Vols, your daily podcast on the Tennessee Volunteers. Part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day.
Hey, good Friday morning, everybody. Welcome to Locked On Vols. I am Eric Kane. So happy to have you guys here making Locked On Vols your first listen each and every day. Shout out everydayers for making this podcast what it is. It's a free download wherever you listen to your podcast. It's a free subscription on the YouTube channel as we continue to make this podcast grow. We're a part of the Locked On Podcast Network, where it is your team every single day. Got a fun show coming up today. Bill Connelley, some nerd stats. It's about that time of the year. He'll have his SP Plus rankings sometime next week, but earlier this week, he put out returning production rankings for all 134 FBS football programs, and Tennessee's down the list quite a bit. I'll tell you what that means. And then in segments two and three, going to bring on our buddy Ryan Schumpert of Rocky Top Insider to preview Tennessee at Texas A&M, Tennessee this final home stretch of the SEC season, and of course Tennessee baseball with opening day just a week away. That and more coming up here today on Locked On Vols. Big shout out to FanDuel Sportsbook, where you can make every moment more over at FanDuel Sportsbook. Okay, so again, like I said, the SP Plus rankings will be out sometime next week for ESPN from Bill Connelley. And again, those are some big-time nerd stats, and it's not for everybody. It's kind of like pro football focus, but I think it can tell a lot about where your roster is and where the overall health of your program is and kind of how that changes throughout the offseason. And so why I like to look at these returning production stats is because a lot of the times when you have a whole lot of production returning, you're set to take a step forward. You're set up to add a couple wins to your resume. Look at Missouri this past year. Missouri in the offseason was ranked number two by Bill Connelley of ESPN in terms of returning production. At least in the month of August, it kind of shifts a couple of times throughout the offseason. And then look at Missouri this year, one of the best programs in the SEC, one of the best seasons in program history for the Tigers. If you look at Kansas, who was ranked number one, Missouri, who was ranked number two, Florida State, who was ranked number three, and Michigan, who was ranked number four. All four of those programs improved by a couple different games, and of course, Michigan won the national title. Florida State was on the playoff picture looking in. Missouri did what it did, and of course, Kansas as well. So it doesn't always mean that if you're ranked down towards the bottom or middle of the road, that your season's going to be a failure. Connor O'Gara over at Saturday Down South points out that and I agree with him because immediately the team I thought of was Alabama. And I'm like, Alabama lost a ton, as it does each and every year. I don't have the exact numbers on Georgia, but Georgia's in that same category. Georgia lost a ton last year and was still, in my opinion, probably the best team in the country, but it didn't make the 14 playoff. But Alabama specifically, looked, and they were ranked 122 in percentage of returning production heading into this season, and it improved this past season and won the SEC championship, and of course was the college football playoff team and bowed out in the semifinals game. So it's not an end-all be-all, but it's something interesting to kind of track. This is where SEC teams rank in terms of returning production from ESPN's Bill Connelley heading into the 2024 season. Number 18 is Texas A&M. Number 25 is Texas. Number 31 is Missouri. Number 32 is Florida. Number 47 is Georgia. Number 50 is Auburn. Number 59 is South Carolina. Number 60 is LSU. 67 is Oklahoma. 68 is Ole Miss. 76 is Vanderbilt. 94 is Tennessee. So when I was referencing the 100s, that was on the offensive side. But 94 overall in terms of offense and defense is Tennessee. 102nd is Kentucky, 109th is Arkansas, 115th is Alabama, 122nd is Mississippi State. So you look at that. I mean, Tennessee's not going to be the 94th best team in the country this year. It'll be much better. Ole Miss is going to be much better than number 68. Again, this is not an end-all be-all. Alabama, again, it did lose some players to the NFL draft. It lost some players to the transfer portal, but Alabama's not going to be the 115th best team in the country. And if you remember, back in years prior when Pruitt was here at Tennessee, and you talk about returning productions and returning starts and everything, Tennessee had a high number each and every year under Pruitt, ranked inside the top 10, but those seasons weren't so great, and we remember those, you know, not too fondly. So, nonetheless, here is how Bill Connelley kind of ranks and the weights that he puts on his rankings in terms of returning production. Percent of returning wide receiver and tight end, this is offense, percent of returning wide receiver, tight end, receiving yards, 23.5% of the overall number. Percent of returning quarterback passing yards, 24% of the overall number. Percent of offensive line, percent of returning offensive line snaps is 47.5% of the number, so that's about half right there. And the percent of running back rushing yards is only 5%. So when you look at where Bill Connelley has Tennessee ranked, and it's all the way down here at 94th overall, yet Tennessee on the offensive side, according to Bill Connelley, returns 46% of production at 107th ranked in the country. So if we kind of look at that, well, let's talk about it. Percent of returning receiver and tight end receiving yards. Well, Brew McCoy didn't have that much last year because he was hurt. Squirrel White is returning. That's a big one. Ormel Keaton is gone. You had Dante Thornton that didn't do much last year. You had Caleb Webb and Chaz Nimrod who played but didn't do an awful lot. So, and your tight ends are gone, both Jacob Warren and McCallum Castle. So I see 23.5% of the number being a big hit for Tennessee simply because you just weren't that great and the guys that you had were either hurt or they're gone now. Percent of returning quarterback passing yards is 24%. Your starting quarterback's gone. And though Nico Iamaleava's got a lot of praise and a lot of hype coming in, it's still going to be a first-year starter where your starting quarterback left. And that's why that's not the point about this end-all be-all. Tennessee takes a dip in these rankings because you're losing your starting quarterback, and the guy that's going to take his spot was not a transfer coming in who started elsewhere. But Nico has such a higher ceiling, and I think Tennessee's going to take a step forward there. But in these returning production rankings, Tennessee takes a hit there because you're losing a starting quarterback. Offensive line percentage of those snaps coming back. Well, you lose Gerald Mincy, who played a ton. And, J.J. Crawford, who played some, and Ollie Lane, who played a lot. But you return an awful lot as well. You return John Campbell, return Cooper Mays, return Javonte Spraggins. You're going to return Dane Davis, who played a lot for you, Jackson Lampley, Andre Carrick. You're adding to Lance Herr, but he wasn't a true starter at LSU. So you take a little bit of a hit there, but not nearly as much as you would. And then where Tennessee takes the biggest hit in terms of percent of returning running back rushing yards, with Jabari Small and, of course, a 1,000-yard rusher in Jalen Wright, that's only 5%. So that didn't make up an awful lot. So Tennessee is ranked again 107th in returning offensive production at 46%. According to ESPN's Bill Connelley. I can't really disagree with that because I think the way he weights things, it makes a little bit of sense. That doesn't mean that Tennessee's going to be horrible. On defense, percent of returning tackles, 69.5%. So 70% of his weighted rankings for defensive returning production is based on the tacklers you bring back. Well, let's think about this. Tennessee says goodbye to Jalen McCullough, tackle machine. Says goodbye to Aaron Beasley, tackle machine. Says goodbye to a lot of starters in the secondary that we'll get to in a moment. So I can see that taking a hit because specifically Aaron Beasley and Jalen McCullough, who had a lot of tackles for you, are now gone. Percent of returning passes defensed, interceptions, or broken up. That's 12%. And when you think about it, the entirety of the secondary is going to be brand new. So that makes a little bit of sense, but it's only 12%. A percent of returning tackles for loss, 10.5%, where you'd wish this percentage would be more, because though Tyler Barron has left the program, you bring back your entirety of your defensive front pretty much, minus Karat Garland, who was never really a star. So you wish that percentage would be a little bit more. And the percentage of returning sacks, 8%. And yes, Tyler Barron had 6, but you bring back Omar Norman Lott, who had 5.5. You bring back James Pearce, who had what, by season's end, what was it, 9.5, 10? I can't even remember. But you wish that percentage was a little bit more. ESPN's Bill Connelley ranks Tennessee's defensive returning production at 66th in the country at 58%. So one other thing before we get to Ryan Schumpert. Bill Connelley kind of breaks these down into tiers in terms of most likely to improve in 2024, like we talked about with Missouri and Michigan and Kansas and some of those other teams at the top of this segment. He also breaks it down in most likely to regress in 2024 in terms of teams that don't have a whole lot of returning production. Tennessee's in this group. All right, he says 14th in the SP Plus rankings in 2023, 94th in returning production overall in 2024. This is what ESPN's Bill Connelley says. Tennessee was all over the place in 2023, losing three SP Plus top 10 teams by an average score of 36-12. That's not great. But otherwise, going 9-1 and with mostly comfortable wins. It was a bit of a reloading year after 2022's 11-win breakthrough, but it appears 2024 might require further reloading. Everyone's excited about the possibilities of blue-chip quarterback Nico Iamaleava, replacing the outgoing Joe Milton III, but that will still produce a drop in experience levels, which is true. You're not getting a transfer from the portal that started elsewhere to come in and take Joe Milton's spot. So in terms of these rankings, again, it's easy to see why they're dropped a little bit because you're losing a starting quarterback. But will still produce a drop in experience levels. And despite the addition of explosive two-lane receiver Chris Brazel II, the skill corps defensive line and secondary will start the 2024 season relatively unproven thanks to both NFL departures and transfers. Okay, you're getting back Brew McCoy, who was injured last year. Squirrel White's coming back. He's really solid. Dante Thornton, I hear you, was a bust last year, but he was starting to turn the corner towards the end of the season. Chris Brazel has not done it at this level, but he comes in with some productions. And, oh yeah, you bring in a five-star Mike Matthews. I don't know if I would agree with that wide receiver notion there, and I especially don't agree with the defensive line. You lose Tyler Barron. Good player. Six sacks last year. Good player. Contract year. He went and did what he needed to do. You bring back James Pearce. You bring back Omar Norman Law, and you bring back everybody else on that defensive front. I disagree with that wholeheartedly. I think the defensive line is going to be fine. So anyway, I find it interesting. It's just something to talk about. It's not the end-all be-all. Remember, Alabama was ranked in the 100s last year in overall returning production. It made it to the 14 college football playoff. But Bill Connelley has, in terms of returning production for Tennessee, overall the 94th team in the country at 52%. Offensively, 46% of its production returns. It's ranked 107th. And defensively, 58% of its production returns, and that is 66 in the country. So something to talk about, not the end-all be-all, but it is interesting to look at it that way. Hey, let's talk to Ryan Schumpert, Rocky Top Insider. We're going to talk Tennessee basketball as it gets ready to go at Texas A&M. Last couple of games of the SEC schedule, or really last couple of games before the true home stretch of the SEC schedule. What needs to happen there, and Tennessee baseball season opener is next week, a week from today. All that and more, it's coming up next as we continue on here on Locked On Vols. Want to tell you about our friends over at FanDuel Sportsbook. Super Bowl 58, it is this weekend. End the season with a W on the biggest game of the year, the biggest stage of the year. You got totals, you got spreads, you got over-unders, you got all that fun stuff, plus individual prop bets, been talking about it all week, but you know, not even the casualest football fans, maybe even non-football fans that want to make some money, will get in on those individual prop bets. Gatorade color at the end of the game, length of the national anthem. The coin toss is going to be heads or tails, 50%. Is the first play going to be a run or a pass? 50%. I mean, have fun indulging yourself in those individual prop bets. It's one of the favorite things I like to do every single Super Bowl. And plus, if you're a new customer over at FanDuel Sportsbook, you can get $200 in bonus bets if your first bet is at $5 or more wins. Just visit FanDuel.com/LockedOn to sign up. That is FanDuel.com/LockedOn. Make every moment more with FanDuel. It's an official sportsbook partner of the NFL. Ryan Schumpert of Rocky Top Insider will join us next. All right, bringing on to the show, Ryan Schumpert of Rocky Top Insider. Ryan, appreciate you for being here, man. It's an exciting time right now for Tennessee basketball. Tennessee baseball is about to start. How you doing today here on this Friday?
I'm doing well. Appreciate you having me on.
Tell me what Tennessee needs to do to handle business down on the road, down in College Station on the road against Texas A&M, coming off a 20-point win where a 13-0 run made it a little interesting late against LSU, but overall Tennessee handled business.
I would point to really playing defense without fouling. I think it's going to be the big thing in this A&M game. That really is what got him in trouble last year at Texas A&M. Wade Taylor, who's the Aggie star, is one of the best in the conference at getting to the foul line and drawing fouls. And I think what we've seen Tennessee maybe have some issues with is their defense. It's kind of a hilarious, a quick aside of feels like their defense is struggling or playing worse and still fifth in adjusted defensive efficiency, according to KenPom. That's how high the standard's been. And a lot of those issues have been fouling and getting guys in foul trouble. And with as conservative as Rick Barnes oftentimes plays guys or plays with guys that pick up two fouls in the first half, like that just feels like the thing that could throw Tennessee off. And then, you know, on the other end, offensively, I think it's about getting what you've gotten in the last two games of just having some balance and having some guys other than Dalton Kinect step up. And I would especially just say Zakai Ziegler and Dalton Kinect, when those two guys are playing well, and they've probably been Tennessee's two best players in SEC play, when they have things going, and not even necessarily at their best, but when they're playing well at to their capabilities, Tennessee's offense is going to be tough to stop.
Yeah, we'll get to the good here in a moment, but one stat that was just glaring from the other night, and again, Tennessee cruised. You know, they made a run there at the end, but Tennessee still led by 10. I mean, won by 20 points, but Tennessee got bullied on the boards down low. I mean, it was, I don't have the numbers in front of me, but it was quite the disparity there. What's the biggest reason for that? Dalton Kinect career high, or maybe at least a Tennessee high of 7 rebounds. Rick Barnes said it should have been 11 post-game, but what was the biggest reason why Tennessee just got beat up on the boards? 18-5, I think, was the number in terms of offensive rebounds that went to LSU instead of Tennessee, but yet Tennessee, because of shooting over 50%, that wasn't a really big of an issue.
You're right. It was very glaring. I mean, you especially say, you said at 18 offensive rebounds for LSU, 21 defensive rebounds for Tennessee. So it was about 50-50 when LSU missed a shot, who was coming down with it. And it was, you know, I don't know what I would point to for the one thing. LSU's been a pretty good offensive rebounding team, not a very good defensive rebounding team. And Tennessee, only five, like you said, five offensive rebounds. So I don't know if I would point to one thing. Now, the guys that you expect for Tennessee to have a lot of rebounds, Josiah Jordan James had five, Jonas Adu had five, Tobey Awaka had one. So their best rebounders didn't rebound very well. I don't know if it's as simple as that or not. Obviously, you give LSU credit, but that was early in the season. Maybe one of the biggest question marks I had for this team was how could they rebound playing these small ball lineups? And they had some issues early in the year, but since then they've been really good, especially on the offensive glass, and they've been average defensively, but it hasn't been an issue like it was last night. So I think I write it off to being more of a one-off performance, but certainly Texas A&M is a team with some size and really attacks the glass hard. That I'm sure that'll be number one emphasis from Rick Barnes leaving the LSU game and heading into tomorrow's showdown in College Station.
Yeah, I mean, Dalton Kinect's been incredible this year. He's been so much fun to watch, and it's been really, really cool to see him kind of integrate himself in the Tennessee team and lead the Tennessee team for much of the season. But, man, Zakai Ziegler's come on really strong in SEC play. Incredible performance, one for the ages that you're always going to remember against Kentucky. Had another 9 assists, I believe, the other night. He's playing on fire. However, and again, it's not like it was 5-10 years ago when it was much different than what it is now. I mean, coming off an ACL tear, it's not as dire as it once was, but he continues to play so many minutes. And then you try to get in some young guys like Cam Carr and kind of mix up those lineups there towards the end, and then a team goes on a run like that. But any worry that Zakai and some of these other guys are playing too many minutes right now? I mean, like, Dalton Kinect at the end of games looks dead. And you've got, we know that brutal two-week stretch to end the regular season. Feels like in some of these games over the next little bit, you maybe want to try to bring some guys off the bench and rest some of your starters when given the opportunity.
It's the one thing that kind of just overhangs all of it, I think. And, you know, part of me does agree with that. I feel like they're having to play Dalton and Zakai and some games Jonas, and certainly earlier in the year they're having to play Josiah Jordan James more than you would like. But another part of me is kind of like, I don't know, man. So most of these best teams in college basketball, they're playing an 8-man rotation, 7-man rotation. Kansas got 5 guys they can trust. So it's not ideal, but I don't know that I hit the panic button about it either. You're certainly not alone in this boat. You know, the one guy, Jordan Ganey, playing well last night, I think is another good sign to be able to give those guys some lesser minutes. And Jemai Meshach's the one that I just, both the last two games, I've kind of left thinking, why did Jemai Meshach not play more? And yeah, maybe that's me nitpicking in a game, two games that they, two good wins for him, but he's a guy that I think's minutes need to get up into 20s. He can play a little bit of point guard if need be. Obviously, we saw that at the end of last year. And maybe it's not being cautious enough because Ziegler did come off the ACL tear. But he's gotten one guy on his team. I feel like he's just got that dog of, I don't think it's going to bother him too much playing 35 minutes most nights. But Dalton, when you're talking about how much they're putting on him on the offensive end, and obviously he's not the best defender, but Rick Barnes still have, you know, high standard for what he's going to give him on that side. He's the one guy that I worry a little bit more about, especially as it's his first year in big-time college basketball, and he obviously is the one that has the target on his back and is defended very, very physically, and a lot of attention is put on him every single night.
Is it as simple as Jordan Ganey coming out of that slump, Jordan Ganey giving you a lot and playing really well, getting more minutes, the reason why Mayshak's minutes have gone down, and really Santiago Vescovi's minutes have gone down a little bit as well.
I think especially with Vescovi it is. And Mayshak, I think that's a big part of it. That's where, you know, I would say to me, Mayshak, the thing about that is the way Mayshak dictates the game with his defense and the fact that he's versatile, that's where I'm like, I don't see the excuse for not playing him. Get to, you know, let him take some of Josiah Jordan James minutes in if, you know, Jordan Ganey and the shooting guards and point guards are playing so well that you can't give him a ton of minutes there. You know, I think he's been right around 15, maybe three straight games now. And to me, what he can do to change the game with his defense and the fact that he's versatile, it's like you just find a spot for him. He'll go. I don't see any reason why he shouldn't be playing 20 minutes every night.
All right, last question. Long time away, a lot of basketball over the next couple of weeks. We know we talked about it, you know, off air yesterday at the stadium that, you know, Tennessee needs to go 5-1, 6-0 over the course of the next 3 weeks and off to a good start with the win over LSU. What will stand in the way of this Tennessee basketball team from making the deep run that it should, given the depth and given the talent that's on this roster?
I would point to two things. And really, if you're talking about not making it out of the first weekend, I think it would just have to be a terrible shooting performance in a night where Dalton Connect struggles, or at least isn't efficient scoring the basketball, and then the guys around him don't make shots. So that's what I would point to first weekend. And now if you're talking about what's keeping him from making the Final Four, the other concern to me would be kind of a combination of interior defense against post players and rebounding the ball. And obviously, Tennessee plays a smaller lineup. Jonas Adu is probably at least one of the best rim protectors when it comes to playing help defense in the country. But, you know, with that slender frame, we've seen him get pushed around by some big guys that are really talented and really physical. Now, you shouldn't see that the first weekend, at least a great one, because most of those great ones are on teams that are going to be much higher seeded. But when you get in the second weekend, you get in Sweet 16, you get in the Elite Eight, there's a good chance you see those guys. And when you look, Tennessee's five losses this year, four of them have come against teams that have premier centers that are very physical down low, have been able to get into Jonas Adu's body and push him around a little bit, and are also very skilled.
Opening day for college baseball. It is literally a week away. This time next week, the nightcap, it'll be Tennessee, somewhere around 8 o'clock Eastern time, taking on Texas Tech in the Shriners Children's Collegiate Baseball Showdown in Arlington, Texas at Globe Life Field. Can't wait to see that in person. So we're going to ask Ryan Schumpert about the Tennessee baseball team and what to expect here when we return as Locked On Balls continues. All right, Ryan Schumpert, Rocky Top Insider, talking a little Tennessee baseball now as we conclude a week's worth of Locked On Vols. The predicted order of finish from the league's 14 head coaches. Last year, we can say that, 14. It's going to go to 16 next year and also going to be ditching divisions. But Tennessee predicted to win or predicted to finish second in the East behind Florida. And overall SEC predicted order of finish, Arkansas got 9 first place votes to win the conference, LSU 3 and Florida 2. Any surprises, or is this kind of about what you expected? Tennessee second behind Florida in the East and Arkansas getting the overall nod.
About what I expected. I was maybe surprised by the margin in which Arkansas was picked to lead or to win the league, especially considering the fact that, yeah, the defending national champions, LSU, in their own division, and a Florida team who made it last year to that title game or title series. And both those teams, especially LSU, have a lot back, and LSU reloaded again in the portal. So, you know, not shocking. Obviously, Arkansas's pitching staff should be the best in the conference, so no major surprise there. And then when you look at Tennessee, I think that was the predicted area. It felt like Florida was going to be picked to win the East, and then Tennessee and Vanderbilt would be right there in some version of 2-3, very close together. And I think it was all of, you know, 2 points that separated them, and in a pretty big gap to South Carolina at 4.
Tennessee last year, coming off the historic 2022 campaign, number one overall seed, all that noise, failed to get to Omaha, losing in game 3 of the Supers here in town to Notre Dame. But going into last season, it was preseason ranked, you know, 2-3-2 by most major polls. And, you know, I spoke with Tony Vitello in an interview before last season. He was like, man, that is not where we need to be. That is not, I mean, we're replacing everybody. And you look around the horn, you replace your first baseman, your second baseman, your third baseman, your shortstop, your backstop. But you did bring back pitching. This year, you bring back a lot of experience. You add in the transfer portal, but the biggest questions are on the mound. We'll get to that in a moment. But most of these national polls have Tennessee as high as 5, but, you know, 8 from the coaches poll, 8 from Baseball America, 9 from D1 Baseball, 11th from Perfect Game. I feel like that is more where this team should be compared to, you know, last year when they were overranked.
Yeah, I think the pitching and coming off the big season is why they were so high last year. And you're right, Tony Vitello was he was telling anybody to listen. He was hollering from the mountaintops that they were not the second best team in the country before the year. And obviously he was proved correct early on. And I think you just have to like, and I know we'll get into the pitching a little bit more in a minute. I think you just have to like the dynamic of a really deep lineup with some proven guys, you know, a handful of proven guys at the top. Now, not all of them at Tennessee, obviously Cannon Peebles and Billy Amick, two guys that are expected to be some of the best bats in this Tennessee order. But an offense that you feel like is really, really good, and a pitching staff that has some questions, has some depth, but has one really good guy you know for sure in Drew Beam, and certainly a really, really talented second guy in A.J. Russell. We'll see what he looks like with an increased workload. And you just feel like Frank Anderson's going to figure it out. And he always does. He's one of the best pitching coaches in the country, I think, every year but his first year at Tennessee, which, you know, he's been there Tony Vitello's whole tenure. Tennessee's had a top five pitching staff in ERA, most of those years top 10. I like the formation, kind of like you said, flip-flopped of last year, where you have the high-end offense that can maybe make a deeper push if you do get to Omaha. It can carry you a little bit early in SEC play, but enough pieces on the mound and a couple really talented guys to hopefully lead Tennessee early in the season or be a big boost for them, and certainly a veteran pitching coach that can push all the right buttons and get all the pieces to fit well together.
Yeah, hoping to find out more information over this weekend. They'll have a couple of scrimmages, and it's going to be almost like a dress rehearsal, if you will, where they'll have like the ones in one lineup going up against the, you know, as close as they can get it, like a Friday, Saturday, and Sunday guy. So it'll be like the pitchers thrown to the ones and vice versa. So maybe we'll know more about this on Monday and Tuesday. But at the time of this recording, man, I mean, I still don't know what it's going to look like. I mean, Drew Beam, there's value to, and I get where a lot of people are saying got to keep him on Sundays, but it would make absolutely no sense for Drew Beam to be the Sunday guy this year. Make no sense. In my opinion, he's got to be Friday or Saturday. But even if that's the case, we know about A.J. Russell, but who's going to be that third guy? I think that there's going to be a couple of guys to begin the season. Couldn't tell you right now who that would be in Dallas next weekend, but I think Derek Schaefer, a true freshman, is going to get some run. When he's stretched out, I think Matthew Dallas will get some run. Potentially, you could see A.J. Causey, which, man, I want him in the bullpen so bad, but he's an option to start you some games, especially early on. Got Xander Seacrest. So what do you like about this starting group that's kind of coming together in terms of maybe what it could look like next weekend?
You're right. It's a ton of different options. And, you know, to me, if I don't know, but my prediction here 8 days out would be that you would see Xander Seacrest be the guy in this opening weekend. We've seen Tony trust the veterans in the past, trust the guys that have been in the program who've worked hard and earned it. And I think while a lot of those other guys have higher ceilings than Xander, I think Xander has some experience. Obviously, he's been the midweek starter. He's pitched some bullpen innings in the SEC. And I think the comparison I'd make of what you almost ideally hoped you could do with him is what Tennessee did with Will Heflin in 2021, where you weren't asking a ton out of him. It was, you're going to go two times through the lineup, give up two or three runs, we're going to be right in the game. And I think that's really all you're going to be asking of a Sunday guy or whoever Tennessee's third starter is. And, you know, Nate Snead, I think, is probably the guy to Wichita State transferred that has the highest ceiling. But when you talk about a Tennessee bullpen that's really going to be flipped from last year and having a lot more lefty arms and right-handed arms and Snead's kind of high-level stuff, it feels like he fits really well in the bullpen. And would that's almost a way that if you can get Xander, and Causey could be another option too, if you can get one of those guys to be solid for you in the weekend rotation, maybe Snead maximizes your potential coming out of the bullpen and being able to use him multiple days in a weekend series.
Yeah, I mean, you know, he's not going to be Chase Burns, but 100-mile-an-hour, you know, fastball worked really well out of the bullpen last year for Tennessee. So,
yeah.
and you're exactly right. Where Tennessee didn't have many lefties out of the pen last year, got an abundance this year. You almost want that flamethrower right-hander to be at your disposal. So we'll see what happens. And you're right. I mean, I think Xander's a guy that, you know, could be in there to begin the season. And then maybe you give a shot to, you know, a Schaefer or to a Matthew Dallas down the line. You know, we'll see. I mean, again, plenty of options. And what you see this upcoming weekend might not be what you see the following weekend. Offensively, last question. Who's the X factor for this baseball team? I think it's an easy answer for me, at least, but you can go a couple different ways. Who's the X factor? Tennessee will go as this player goes, position player-wise.
Well, it's funny. We actually RTI, we recorded our season preview podcast, and we're talking about the same thing. To me, the two guys I'd go, one to me is more obvious, is Blake Burke, just because you know he's going to be in there, and we've seen him at his best. Man, he was really, really good. And in SEC play last year, he really, really struggled. And now they have some more options behind him this year. If he were to struggle the same way, they might be able to turn
to. Yeah, they had no options last year.
No, they didn't. They could turn to a Robin, or they could turn to Dalton Bargo. But still, you know, he's the guy you think is going to be in there. He's the junior. He's the proven guy. This is where you look for a leap. And we know when Blake Burke is good, Blake Burke is really, really good. Yes. And kind of in the same way, another guy I'd point to is Hunter Ensley in center field. The ceiling isn't as high, but when you're talking about a Tennessee lineup that really, besides whoever ends up starting one of the middle infield spots besides Christian Moore, every other bat in there, all seven other guys besides that and Ensley, you know, can really be top end bats. Hunter Ensley, he was solid last year. He was really reliable. If he finds another gear, I think you're talking about a Tennessee offense that can be one of the best in the country. And you know, again, it's obviously I think his floor is pretty high. I think we already saw that last year. So, you know, maybe if he struggles, you know, it's not as much they'll go as he goes. But I think if he can take another step forward, he's a guy you know is going to be in there in the lineup every single day. I think that just gives another burst to a Tennessee offense that should be real vastly improved over last season and one of the SEC's best.
All right, I'll lob one more question. Because of the injuries, obviously there's a lot going on at shortstop right now, but of the three games next weekend, how many of those games will Christian Moore get the start at shortstop? I'm going to say two. And then I think the other, if he's at short, I do think Bradkey Lowry will be at second. I think it's just going to be those two guys flip-flopping around.
I would agree the same way. I would probably say two with Moore. It'll be two or three. I don't think it'll be any less than two. And to me, that's what becomes interesting. Whatever games Moore doesn't start at short, I think it'll definitely be Bradkey Lowry. To me, he's by far, with Antigua out, the next best option at short. If you play Moore at short, does somebody else get an opportunity at second? Does Alex Perry or Camden Bates maybe get a chance? And I don't know that. Maybe it'll be Bradkey Lowry at second too. But I think with Moore at short, that opens up the possibility for maybe some more guys to get opportunities.
Yeah, and where's Alex Perry, you know, health-wise? He's been hitting this week, but he's been dealing with a tender hamstring like everybody else in that situation. So I think when everybody's healthy, Christian Moore is your second baseman, but you enter the season. And again, it's better to have this now than in May and June. You enter the season a little bit banged up at shortstop. So, Ryan, a lot of great stuff over there at Rocky Top Insider. Crossover season, it's beginning for you. Basketball and baseball coming up. What do we have looked forward to over on the site this afternoon and this weekend?
Yeah, tons of Tennessee basketball stuff, baseball stuff. We'll start rolling out all our previews starting on Monday. We'll have one a day leading up to it. Jack Foster will be in Arlington for the opening weekend, and I'll be covering all the basketball stuff. So plenty of stuff there. Had a feature. Kind of feature-ish story, maybe not quite a feature story, on Wednesday on how Dalton Connect and Jemai Meshack playing one-on-one on Dalton Connect's visit to Tennessee was kind of the first indication that Connect could be this guy for Tennessee that he's become. So go check that out. And then obviously, like I said, plenty of basketball and baseball stuff is, like you said, we enter that fun crossover season in February and into March.
Go check that story out at RockyTopInsider.com. Give Ryan a follow at rshump00 on Twitter, on the X. Ryan, thanks so much, man.
Yeah, appreciate you having me on.
All right, that is going to do it here for this edition of Locked On Vols. Can't thank you enough for being here and making me a part of your morning routine. Again, it's a free download. It's a free subscription wherever you get your podcasts, and, of course, on YouTube as well. Stay safe this weekend. We'll see what Tennessee does on the basketball court. We'll see if we get some more answers to Tennessee baseball as we roll into opening week. All that and more. Plus, the court hearing on Tuesday. We'll have you covered from every single angle right here on Locked On Vols. Appreciate you guys so much, and enjoy the rest of your weekend, everybody.